Good morning. Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
All right. I love when you guys get it. That's fantastic. We are here to celebrate that the Lord has risen. Amen. There's a reason that we gather together here and all around the world and online and everywhere that any Christian calls home. Today we gather because the Lord has risen and forgiven us our sins. That is the most amazing. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Honestly, when we were praying today, one thing came into my thought. If we can't get excited about Jesus rising from the dead, why are we even doing here? Right? Because that's exciting. I mean, come on, guys. It's like God rose. And if he rose, we are forgiven. That is amazing. Mm-hmm. Amen. So today is an exciting day. Let's stand together. We're going to open up in a word of prayer, and then we're going to do some worship. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you rose again. We thank you, Father, that we stand here together as witnesses, as fellow witnesses with the apostles, that they believe that you rose again. They saw your presence, and because they saw you, we believe. Thank you, Jesus, that you rose again to forgive our sins. Because you've forgiven our sins, we can believe that you rose. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the sacrifice. Thank you, Lord God, for this time of reminder that you are alive, that you did not stay on the cross, that the tomb did not stay closed, but that you are alive and rose and are with us, and one day you're going to take us home to be with you. And we cannot wait for that day, Lord God. So, Lord Jesus, let us put our hands together and lift up our hearts as we sing to you this morning about your greatness. In your name I pray. Amen. Let's sing together this morning.
Greatest day in history. Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. We sing. And oh, happy day. Happy day, you wash my sin away. And oh, happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. When I stand in that place, meeting face to face, I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace, earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Sin away, and oh, happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. Oh, oh, happy day, happy day, you wash my sin away, and oh, happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. And oh, what a glorious day, what a glorious way, that you have saved me. And oh, what a glorious day, what a glorious name. Happy
Amen. Amen. All right, this morning I'm going to show you a new song, but I'm going to need your help in one very specific part. And all you have to say is, hey. Say it with me. Hey. That's all you're going to do. Okay, you're going to see where it's very simple. The chorus goes like this. He's our rescuer. Hey. He's our rescuer. Hey. We are free from sin forevermore. So we sing that again. He's our rescuer. Hey. He's our rescuer. Hey. We are free from sin forevermore. And oh, how sweet the sound. Hey. Oh, what grace abounds. Hey, we will praise the Lord, our rescuer. We'll try that again from the top. Here we go. He's our rescuer. Hey, he's our rescuer. Hey, we are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Hey, oh, what grace abounds. Hey, we will praise the Lord, our rescuer. Very good. He's good news for the captives, and good news for the shame. There is good news for the one who walked away. There is good news for the doubter, the one religion failed. For the good Lord has come to seek and save. Amen. Here we go. He's our rescuer. Hey, he's our rescuer. Hey. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Oh, how grace abounds. Hey, we praise the Lord, our rescuer. He is beauty for the blind man, riches for the poor. He is friendship for the one the world ignores. He is pasture for the weary, rest for those who strive. Oh, the good Lord is the way, the truth, the life. Oh, yes, the good Lord is the way, the truth, the life. Here we go. He's our rescuer. Hey. He's our rescuer. Hey. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Oh, how grace abounds. Hey, we will praise the Lord, our rescuer. So come and be chainless. Come and be fearless. Come to the foot of Calvary. Cause there is redemption for every affliction here at the foot of Calvary. Here we go. So come and be chainless. You come and be fearless. Come to the foot of Calvary. So there is redemption for every affliction here at the foot of Calvary. Here we go. He's our rescuer. Hey, he's our rescuer. Hey, we are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Hey, oh, how grace abounds. Hey, we will praise the Lord, our rescuer. One more time. He's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. Hey, we are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Hey, oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. Amen.
Amen.
Good job. Jesus paid it all, amen. It's a good thing that we can say that, because there's no way we could pay for our sins ourselves. There's nothing we could ever do. There's not enough power in the world for us to forgive ourselves from sin or for pay for our sins. But Jesus in his mercy paid it for us. Amen? We'll sing this morning.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all.
Cause
Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. And sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Jesus made it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it.
We'll sing that again,
because Jesus made it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
One more time.
Cause Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow.
Thank you, Jesus, that you washed us white as snow. Thank you, Lord God.
Risen today, alleluia. Signs of men and angels say, alleluia. Raise your joys in triumph time, alleluia. Sing hymns and earth's reply, alleluia. Oh, glorious King. Alleluia. Where, O death, is now thy sting. Alleluia. Dying ones, he all the same. Alleluia. Where thy victory, O grave. Alleluia.
He's not dead.
He is not dead. He is alive. Christ has led, alleluia, following our exalted head, alleluia, made like him, like him we rise, alleluia, ours the cross, the grave, the skies, alleluia,
he's not dead, we declare,
he is not dead.
Yes, Lord, you are not dead. You are alive. And we stand here, Lord God, to declare that to the world that our God lives. He is not dead. He is not weak. We are children of the living God, the Almighty King, the one who is willing to forgive. Thank you, Jesus, for gathering us here this morning to celebrate that together. Thank you, Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you for worshiping. You may be seated.
The sound of sorrow echoes in the streets. A song of grief, a hymn of defeat, a dirge. Injustice and tragedy converge on Calvary, and the word was silenced. The hope of humanity lay lifeless in a borrowed tomb. As darkness loomed like a thousand years without the sun, the taste of fear on every tongue, longing to savor and see the goodness of a Savior. We could hardly hear the sound of two or three gathered in your name. We were scattered like skeptics, helpless and ashamed, sheep without a shepherd, disillusioned and dejected. We were desperate for something, for someone to rescue us from what Friday had done. But when the sun rose from its grave on the third day, Sunday came and everything changed. A melody of misery became a brilliant symphony of life. Oh, death, where is your sting? Swallowed up in victory, the greatest day in history was a Sunday. He is risen. We are forgiven. Let the church bells ring. Let the set free sing a new song on Sunday. the reverberation of redemption, an open invitation for every tribe, tongue, and nation to come and see what God has done. His radical love, slain in the public square, but when they came to the grave, nobody was there. This is the good news, the fullness of an empty tomb, where death took its final breath at the hands of a man who had been dead himself until Sunday, when everything changed.
These kids know the first verse of Jesus Loves Me, and we're hoping that you join us in singing it. If you want to sing Jesus Loves Us, go for it. But the next three verses, we hope that you will help us sing it. We know the chorus. Join us.
Thank you. That's a tough act to follow. Wow. Great job, kids. Good morning. Nice to see you. Happy Easter to each one. I'm getting a bit of a ring up here. If you could just dial it back just a smidge would be great. And then I hopefully won't be too loud. All right. Matthew 28 tells the story of Easter Sunday morning. I want to read it to you. Words are on the screen behind me. Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone and sat on it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. Then the angel spoke to the woman. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I know you're looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said would happen. Come, see where his body was lying. And now, go quickly and tell his disciples that he's risen from the dead. And he's going ahead of you to Galilee. You'll see him there. Remember what I've told you." Easter Sunday, one of our highlights of the calendar year at our church. Well, as I was preparing a message for this morning, I received some words of wisdom from a longtime pastor friend. Here's what he said. Preaching at Easter can be like watching a movie where everyone knows how the story ends before it starts. All the suspense is gone. We know the plot. Jesus was arrested, he was tried, he was crucified, he rose from the dead. So what in the world do you preach on? He said, focus on why it matters. And that's what I want to do this morning. I want to focus on why the whole Easter story matters. But before we dive into it, would you bow with me? We're going to pray. Father God, thank you, thank you, thank you, that in your divine wisdom, that at just the right time, you sent your one and only Son to this earth, and we celebrate that every Christmas. And then again, according to your divine plan, when the time was right, your Son willingly gave himself up as a sacrifice for our sin. Thank you that the story doesn't end on the cross. Thank you that there's an empty tomb. And thank you that the resurrection of our Savior means so much to us. Help us see that, understand it, and embrace it this morning, I pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Matthew chapter 16 tells us that before his death, a year before his death, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hand of the elders, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and on the third day raised to life. It was a message that Jesus had alluded to since, well, the very beginning of his public ministry. You can trace back to the first Passover that he celebrated as leader of the disciples, and he found himself standing in a temple court, confronted by Pharisees who were asking him, "On what authority do you say the things that you say? Who gives you authority, the right to do the things that you do? Who are you, Jesus?" The story's told in John chapter 2. And as they question his authority, he said, "If you take this temple and destroy it, 3 days later, I'll rebuild it." It was a rather vague reference, admittedly, to the death and resurrection. And John writes years later, after Christ has risen, with the benefit of hindsight, that the temple Jesus spoke of was his body and that he was raised from the dead. His disciples recalled what he said. And then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. Notice those words, "then they believed." There are times when I read the gospel account of the life of Jesus. I don't know if you do this. I read it and I think, How did they not get it? I mean, they heard him talk. They knew the prophecies. They saw the miracles. And then just when I'm ready to crown myself the smartest student in the classroom, I'm reminded I have this incredible benefit of hindsight. I know how the story lives because I live on this side of the cross, this side of the empty tomb, this side of the ascension and the promise to return. Of course I get it. They struggled to connect the dots. But then when I think of that a little more, I realize that many people struggle to connect the dots. Jesus spoke about his death and his resurrection from the start of his public ministry right up until the night before he was arrested. And they didn't get it. It wasn't until after the resurrection that those closest to him said, "Oh, that's what you meant." And even then you have the guy like Thomas who says, "I'm not sure. I need more proof. I'm struggling to connect the dots." If you're someone who struggles to connect the dots, you're not alone. I'm hoping I can help you connect them this morning. Curious what it would take for you to come to the place where you could say, "Then I believed. Then I believed." There had been plenty of signs that Jesus was who he said he was. Take the events of John 11, for example. Mary and Martha sent a message to Jesus telling him that their brother Lazarus is sick and they want him to come and visit them. I'm going to pick up the story in verse 4. When he heard this, Jesus said, "The sickness will not end in death. No, it's for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, so when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was 2 more days. And then he said to his disciples, "Let's go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "a short while ago the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you're going back?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they will see by this world's light. It's when a person walks at night that they stumble, for they have no light." After he had said this, he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I'm going there to wake him up." His disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get better." They really weren't getting the story, were they? Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. And for your sake, I'm glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let's go to him." On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. The Gospel of John doesn't include a whole lot of the miracles of Jesus. Not like some of the other Gospels. But when John references one of them, he calls them a sign. It may not sound like a big difference, a miracle, a sign. But when he calls them a sign, he does it with the goal of pointing beyond the display of power to the one who holds the power. Miracles can leave you saying, "Wow." In John's mind, a sign says, "Oh, wow. I know who holds that power." So that's what's happening here. No one could mistake, when Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead, who holds the power of life and death. It's a message that would be reissued just a few weeks later when Jesus was crucified and rose from the dead, the event we celebrate this morning. And yes, Jesus had raised others from the dead to life. There's a widow's son in Luke 7, daughter of Jairus in Matthew 9. But verse 17, which we just read, said that Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. And that makes this story a little different than the other ones. You see, in those days, prior to all the medical knowledge we have today, there was a belief that if a person was declared dead, they could still come back to life in 48 hours. That sounds strange. But the argument was, well, maybe the person who declared them dead misread the situation. Maybe they had slipped into a coma. Maybe they were just having a really, really, really deep sleep. So even though Jews usually buried their dead the day they died, there was still this 48-hour window where that status could change. I mention that because in verse 6, it says that when Jesus heard that Lazarus was sick, he waited two more days before going. Why? He wanted everyone to know that Lazarus was really, really, really dead, not just having a good sleep. There'd be no arguing when he called him out of that tomb. This man was dead. And this would be for the Father's glory, Jesus says. I'll pick up the story. Verse 18, now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem. And many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. One writer calls that a masterpiece in planned ambiguity. Martha thinks Jesus is pointing ahead to the end of times, but Jesus is promising something more. And she says, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus says to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me, even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe you're the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world. Throughout history, there have been skeptics who try to cherry-pick certain verses from the Psalms, from Ecclesiastes, and twist them into some sort of evidence that death is the end of our story. But with one statement, I am the resurrection and the life. Jesus says, death is just the end of the beginning. There's more to come. I'll talk about that more in a moment. Verse 38, Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there's a bad odor, for he's been there 4 days. Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you'll see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you've heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. There's a number of lessons I want to take from this story that apply to Easter and to our lives. There's three of them I'm going to highlight. The first one is this. When I read that Jesus heard Lazarus was sick and stayed 2 more days, I'm reminded it's sometimes hard to recognize God's love. Verses 5 and 6 are clear that Jesus loves Mary, loves Martha, loves Lazarus, but he doesn't rush to be by their side. Somehow that doesn't fit with my picture of how God would express his love. Does it fit with yours? Think about the last time you prayed about something that was really, really urgent to you. When did you expect God to answer? Before or after you said amen? We want answers quickly. We expect them to arrive quickly. The scene that unfolds here is one of those scenes that leads people to make statements like, if God loved me, then he'd show up on time. If God loved me, then I won't get sick. If God loved me, then my children will be protected and safe and healthy all the days of their life. If God loved me, my spouse wouldn't die. If God loved me, I won't die alone. If God loved me, I won't struggle, I won't suffer, I won't be miserable. If God loved me, you fill in the blank. There's nothing that threatens our mental image of God's love more than unanswered prayer. When what we see is not what we expect. And you see it in Martha. I'm just going to remind you of the words. Jesus arrives, and what does she say? If only you had arrived earlier. It's kind of a nice way of saying, Jesus, this is your fault. Because you didn't answer my prayer the way I wanted you to. Which takes me back to my first takeaway. Sometimes it's hard to recognize God's love. Because it isn't expressed in the way that I anticipate it would be. Dare I say, should be? At least in my way of thinking. Warren Wiersbe points out that God's love does not guarantee we'll be sheltered from the problems and pains of life. We must never think that love and suffering are incompatible. They came together in the life of Jesus. So why are we so surprised when they come together in our lives as well? God's love doesn't always arrive in the way, shape, and form that we anticipate. So sometimes it's hard to recognize. But know this. God loves you. And nothing will change that. So don't let a delayed or even an unanswered prayer, at least unanswered from your perspective, distort your picture of God. Ask Jesus to adjust your vision. Because he knows there's going to be times when it's difficult to recognize his love. That's my first takeaway. Here's the second one. When Jesus says the sickness will not end in death, I'm reminded that the thing we fear most is not the end of our story. Have you noticed? People invest countless dollars and endless hours fighting the effects of aging, hoping to stave off death as long as possible. We resist it with everything we've got. We fight to survive. We fight to struggle to live. It's self-preservation. Some of us take it a little further because we want to look like 20 or 30 years younger than we are. But we fight it with everything we got. And yet, as I've said before, the death rate for human beings has always hovered right around that 100% mark. There's a couple of exceptions you can find in Scripture. Enoch, Elijah, they're taken direct to heaven, but most of us, that's not the case. Unless Jesus returns before we die, everyone in this room, this is not the cheeriest thought I know on Easter Sunday morning, but we're going to face death. So the question becomes, are we ready for it? Are we prepared? But here's the really good news. Death is not the end of our story. One of my favorite songs, it has a title, it's the end of the beginning. And it truly is. Yes, Jesus was crucified, but he rose again. He walked out of the tomb, and one day you and I get to follow in the steps. Alive forever. Which leads to my third thought. That I'd say is a good takeaway from the story. And it's when I hear Jesus say, Lazarus, come out, I'm reminded that this story gives us a glimpse of what is to come. Lazarus, come out. In many ways, the raising of Lazarus foreshadows the resurrection of Jesus. They happened really close to one another. About 3 weeks is what most suggest separate the two events. Both men had died long enough to be declared dead, and both men walked out of the tomb alive. One walked out on his own power. One walked out never to die again. That's Jesus. Resurrected as opposed to being raised from the dead. Subtle but significant difference. The resurrection of Jesus points ahead to the moment in time when you and I learn that even though we like to think we're pretty good people, in God's eyes we are dead in our trespasses and sins. Dead. But thankfully, that doesn't need to be the end of our story. We don't need to stay dead. I often quote hymns in my messages. This morning, I'm not going to quote a hymn. It's a song I heard a couple months ago. It's been stuck in my head on repeat for months now. It's a song by David Crowder. And he describes Jesus with a term that I hadn't heard stated this bluntly before. Maybe that's why it caught my attention. The song's called Grave Robber. I've heard Jesus referred to as a friend of sinners, the lamb that was slain, the Son of God. Till that song, I never heard him referred to as a grave robber. But let me share just a couple of lines from the song. Dave Crowder sings, I got stolen by the grave robber, picked me up from that rock bottom, washed my soul in that holy water and brought me back to life. One more stone rolled away, one more sinner saved by grace. This dead man, he ain't dead no longer, all because of the grave robber. Taking my sin, taking my shame, breaking my soul out of these chains, I'm a dead man living, and God did it. Those words, they link directly to a statement Paul makes in Colossians chapter 2. You were dead in your sins. Not just asleep, not just in a coma, dead. It's true of each and every one of us. But Paul continues, but God gave you new life with Jesus and brought out of that grave. If you haven't responded to God's offer of salvation, there is still time. 2 Peter 3 reminds us that God is patient. He doesn't want anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. He wants us to understand that Jesus came to this earth to pay the penalty our sin deserved, because no matter how hard we tried, we can never pay the debt we owed. The good news is we don't have to. Jesus paid it all, once and for all, and that means we can find peace with God. We're all invited to experience that peace. So have you found it? If not, you can find it today. I'd love to help you connect the dots. But I'd be remiss if I didn't say don't wait too long. Because while God is patient, there will come a day when, in hindsight, you'll say, oh, that's what I missed. But it'll be too late. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, thank you for your incredible sacrifice on our behalf. Thank you for paving the way for us to find peace with God that lasts not just for a moment, but for eternity. Thank you for raising us up out of that grave where we were dead in our trespasses and sin. Thank you that it's a message you communicated from the beginning of your public ministry straight through to the day that you were taken to the cross and the day you rose from the dead. And it's a message you continue to proclaim to us by your Holy Spirit even today, all these years later. May we connect the dots. Help us not miss out on the peace we can find in Jesus, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just stand with us again as we close our service with one last song. It would help if I plug my guitar in. Hang on.
Christ the Lord is risen today, alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high, alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply. Again, our glorious King, alleluia. Where, O death, is now thy sting, alleluia. Dying once, he all doth save, alleluia. Where thy victory, O great, alleluia.
We sing, he's not dead.
He is done, alleluia. Fought the fight, the battle's won, alleluia. Death in vain forbids him right, alleluia. Christ has opened paradise, alleluia.
We sing, he's not dead.
He is not dead.
Christ, we sing it one more time.
He is not dead. He is alive. He has his hope in Jesus Christ.
So we now.
So we now with Christ has led.
Lord God, we thank you that you are risen indeed, that you are alive. Thank you, Jesus, for bringing us here today to remember that you are alive. And because you're alive, we get to live. That death is not the end. It's the end of our beginning. Thank you, Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Go with peace of Christ. And do me a huge, huge favor. Give a huge round of applause to the kids who did and the workers who helped get the kids organized to do that amazing special that they did. Please congratulate any kid that you see. They did an awesome job. It was fantastic today. So thank you, volunteers and kids. That was great. Thank you, guys. Have a great afternoon. Happy Easter.